talk today is going to be about the 100 year anniversary of the Battle of Gallipoli, Çanakkale. We have a special guest today, come from Turkey. He's come all the way from Turkey just to be here to give this speech. His name is Ertan Karpazlı. He's a Turkish Cypriot, London born and raised in London, and works for TRT World in Turkey today. He will be discussing the Battle of Çanakkale and the Turkish Cypriots' role in this battle. Our second speaker today is going to be Mustafa Kureyşi, who again is a Turkish Cypriot born in London, raised in London, and he's also the chairman of the Cezire Association, and he will be talking about Turkish prisoners of war based in Famagusta, Malta, during the British period. The third and final talk will be by myself, which will be about the aftermath of Gallipoli and the decline of Turkish influence in Cyprus during the British period. Lastly, we'll have questions and answers by our Libyans, and then we'll have some refreshments and networking. But we'd like to start the talk with a supplication prayer for those who lost their lives 100 years ago in Gallipoli, Çanakkale.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسولنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم يا ربي Peygamber Efendimiz'e aleyhissalatü vesselamın ruhu saadeti için İnsan oğluna göndermiş olduğum bütün peygamberler, evliyalar, enbiyalar, şehitler, şühedalar ama bilhassa ya Rabbi, Çanakkale'de vermiş olduğumuz binlerce şehitlerin ruhu şad olması için, Allah rızası için, El-Fatiha. İstiklal
Marşı. Actually, what I'll be focusing on is not so much on the Battle of Çanakkale itself, but more about the Turkish War of Independence in general. And the dates of the Turkish War of Independence can vary according to different academics. Generally speaking, when you say Turkish War of Independence, it refers to the period between 1919 and 1922. But we can extend that. I would like to begin by focusing on the beginning of the British occupation of Cyprus, which started in 1878. And I'm going to be taking up to the point of the rebellions in Cyprus against the British occupation in 1931. And this is the period I want to focus on, but we've chosen to name the talk after the Battle of Çanakkale, because the Battle of Çanakkale is almost like a symbol of the entire Turkish War of Independence. And I would like to put forward my own personal opinion that the Turkish War of Independence still hasn't ended. We are still in the struggle, as Turkish Cypriots particularly, to gain our rights from the international community. And although this might not be in the form of fighting, as was in the time of the earlier part of the century, this struggle still is still going on, it's continuing. And we need to carry on this struggle, albeit in a peaceful way. But looking forward to the future, looking forward to achieving peace with our neighbours and even within ourselves in the future, we also need to focus a lot more on our past. We need to know where we came from in order to know where we're going. And I've chosen to focus on this particular period in my research because I think this period is something that is by going through the Turkish Cypriot participation in the Turkish War of Independence, no one can ever have the right to come up to us ever again in the future and ask us to prove our Turkishness. Because we've already, as a community, we've already done enough. We've shed our blood, we've given our money, we've made so many sacrifices as a community in the earlier part of this century that nobody should be asking us to prove our Turkishness to them. And I would like to prove this in my talk right now. So I'm going to begin in the period of 1878, when the British first occupied Cyprus. And before that, actually, I would like to point out that the reason why the British occupied Cyprus in 1878 was because of the Ottoman Empire going financially bankrupt. 200 years of wars with Russia, and one of the wars with Russia really strained the Ottoman economy. And actually there was one point in the late 1700s where Turkish Cypriots made up around 50% of the population of Cyprus, if not more. This is according to a researcher called Mehta Hatay, who collected a lot of population statistics. But for some reason, heading into the 1800s, the mid-1800s, our population dropped from around 50% of the island to around 25%. And we believe that the reason for this population drop is because many Turkish Cypriots were enlisted into the Ottoman army during these wars with Russia. A lot of them were sent to the battlefront, and a lot of them didn't return. So you can just imagine around, you know, in a matter of 100 years, half the Turkish Cypriot population is killed or gone missing. So we have, as a people, we survived a huge trauma in that period. And these wars with Russia were continuing before 1878. In 1877, Britain and France were supporting the Ottoman Empire in the wars against Russia for the Crimean Peninsula, which is located south of Ukraine. And the Ottomans unfortunately lost that war. So the Ottomans and the British, they made a deal. They said, British said, okay, we need an ally to protect our corridor from the Mediterranean to British India. The Ottomans have been our ally, they've been doing that for a while now, but the Ottomans are failing to fulfill their obligations to this alliance. So the British said they made a deal with Sultan Abdul Hamid, and the British were going to locate their soldiers in Cyprus, and by locating their soldiers and their navy there, they were going to protect the eastern Mediterranean from falling under Russian influence. And it was an agreement actually between the British and the Ottomans. And but the territory of Cyprus was still technically part of the Ottoman Empire. It was only supposed to be a temporary solution until the Russian threat stopped existing. So this is how the British occupation began. As soon as the British occupation began, within a year, the British authorities, they started something called the Covenantages, which is basically translated into English as the Legislative Council. And this was a parliament of about 18 members. Six of those members were appointed by the British, and the other 12 were elected from the people of Cyprus. Nine were to be Greek Cypriots, and three were to be Turkish Cypriots. And the Turkish Cypriots, even though they were technically a minority in the island, you have to consider that when Cyprus was part of the Ottoman Empire, the majority, if you look at what the Ottoman Empire as a whole, it was a Muslim empire. So Turkish Cypriots, although a minority in Cyprus, in the Ottoman Empire as a whole, they were part of a majority identity, a Sunni Muslim, Turkic-based identity. But suddenly, Cyprus is split from the Ottoman Empire, and they go from belonging to a majority to belonging to a minority on a small island. So that was quite traumatic for them, and the Turkish Cypriots actually protested this move by the British to make them a minority in this legislative council. We have an example of the Grand Mufti of the time in Cyprus, called Sayyid Ahmed Hasim. The Grand Mufti was basically considered to be the elected leader of the Turkish Cypriots. He protested this change. He wrote a letter to the British and Ottoman authorities. Also, the Turkish ambassador, or the Ottoman ambassador, to London, Musurus Pasha, also protested this change to the British Foreign Minister at the time, Lord Granville. The British, they didn't really have the right to do this. Like, they were just there as a military occupation, not to change the structure of the way Cyprus was governed, the way it's run. what happened at the time was the Turkish Cypriots were then split into two groups. One was referred to as the Halkçılar, and these were people who were kind of grassroots Turkish Cypriots. These were people who were electing their own people. They wanted their own system in force. And the other group were referred to as the Efkaf Çılar. And I'm sure most of you have heard of Efkaf, the Turkish Cypriot Foundations. This foundation was central, was core to the existence of the Turkish Cypriot community. It was our economic heart, if you could imagine. And the first thing that the British did was that they took the properties belonging to the Efkaf. They seized the public Turkish Cypriot properties, and they chose their own kind of puppets to run the Efkaf for them. So in 1903, actually, a man called Musa Ilfambe, he was put at the head of the Efkaf. He was a pro-British candidate. And during his time, there was a lot of corruption regarding the Efkaf, regarding the public properties of Turkish Cypriots. He entered the elections for the Legislative Council in 1911. He was running against a man called the Grand Mufti Ziyai Efendi, who was the leader of the Turkish Cypriots at the time. And in order to gain votes, Musa Irfan was handing out Turkish Cypriot public properties and privatizing them in return for votes. He failed to win that election. But you can imagine this guy in charge, and he was in charge until like the mid 1920s. During this time, there was a lot of corruption. A lot of the Turkish Cypriot properties became privatized, and the quality of the Turkish Cypriot mosques and schools that were all bound to Efkaf, they started to decrease. Meanwhile, the Greek Cypriots, they had their own similar system with the church, and they had their own Efkaf. Cypriots, so to speak. And for some reason, the British decided not to interfere with that. So they continued to prosper, and the economic powerhouse of the Turkish Cypriots was taken away. A lot of their power was lost because of this. In 1913, during the Turkish wars with Greece, the city of Thessalonica fell to Greece. Up until this time, the British and the Ottoman Empire had been very close allies. The British were relying on the Ottoman Empire to protect the Straits of the Bosphorus from a Russian advance. And when we talk about Russian advance, we're not talking about just Russia invading everything. Russia was also setting up satellite states in the Balkan regions, for example, Romania, Bulgaria. These countries, actually Orthodox countries in Eastern Europe, were being used by Russia to advance towards the Mediterranean. And Britain was relying on the Ottoman Empire to stop these countries like Bulgaria from advancing. But in 1913, when Thessalonica fell to Greece, the British started reconsidering their relationship with the Ottoman Empire, and they realized that Greece was rising in power, and they thought to themselves, hold on a minute, if we work with Greece instead, they're more likely to protect our interests than the Ottomans. The Ottomans are clearly not doing a very good job. So the British switched their alliance to the Greeks, and then the Ottoman Empire had no choice but to enter World War I on the side of Germany, Britain's enemy. And this all led up to the Battle of Çanakkale, which took place in 1915. Before I get into that, I'd just like to point out that how these politics were affecting life on the island. The World War I, you know, and everything around it, was an international war, and this actually affected the people of Cyprus. So on one hand, when you had Turkish Cypriots going to Turkey, the front, as volunteer fighters to fight for the Ottoman Empire, you also had Greek Cypriots who were going to Greece to fight for Greece against the Ottoman Empire. So you can imagine the atmosphere in the island, where you have two groups of people rooting for two sides. And according to my information that I received, around 2,500 Greek Cypriot men joined the Greek forces in Greece in 1913 to fight against the Ottoman Empire. And if you think about the population of the Greek Cypriots back then, that amounts to, my estimate, 1 in 20 or 1 in 30 Greek Cypriot men going to fight for Greece. Just imagine what life was like for Turkish Cypriots on the island with people who were supporting this campaign against the Ottomans. And we have from Nikosia, Lefkosia, 2,158 Greek Cypriots went to join the Greek army, 1,000 from Paphos, 974 from La Rocha, Marash, 850 from Limassol, 600 from Larnaca, 390 from Gilme. In total, we have many who actually registered as well, and around 5,000 who registered. As a result of the Ottoman Empire siding with Germany in World War I, the British decided to punish the Ottoman Empire by officially annexing Cyprus from the Ottomans. At first, this was actually accepted by the Turkish Cypriot community. Not because they really wanted it, it was basically because they had no choice. Either they accepted it, or they rejected it, and they were exiled from the island. So we had a Turkish Cypriot judge called Ali Rifat, Mufti Ziyagi, Musa Irfan as well, the head of the EFKAF, and we also had a member of the Legislative Council called Mehmet Şevket, who met with the British High Commissioner, Sir Hamilton Adams, and they said that they would accept the British annexation, but in return they wanted the British to guarantee the rights of the Turkish Cypriots to remain in Cyprus. And the Turkish Cypriots actually were given an ultimatum by the British. The British basically said to them at this point that they had 2 years to decide what they wanted to do. Either they were going to become British citizens and remain in Cyprus, or they were going to reject British citizenship, retain their Ottoman citizenship, and leave the island within 2 years. And as a result of this, 20,000 Turkish Cypriots actually left the island and fled to Anatolia. So you can imagine that's like about one-fifth of our population just went just like that. That was the first exodus, the first official exodus of Turkish Cypriots from the island of Cyprus. Regarding the Battle of Çanakkale itself, I hate to disappoint you, but there is not much written evidence regarding Turkish Cypriots who actively fought in the Battle of Çanakkale. We do have some names. We have the name of Mahmutsuki Bey, who was a commander for the Ottoman forces in the Battle of Çanakkale. And he was actually martyred on the Battle of Çanakkale. We have instances of Turkish Cypriots who were working as doctors on the battlefield in the Battle of Çanakkale. I mean, I have a number of names here, but regarding the story behind the names, there's not much information. This is passed down orally, and I would like to hopefully at some point research that even more. But what we have, which is more interesting, is that since the Cyprus was part of the British Empire at the time, after it was annexed, many Turkish Cypriots were recruited into the British Army, and many of them were sent to different battle fronts. A number of them were sent to the Suez Canal in Egypt as British soldiers. And according to my research, we had 16,000 Turkish Cypriot and Greek Cypriot members of the British Army, who were mainly working as muleteers. You know, they were the ones who were basically in charge of taking, carrying supplies to and from the battlefront. And we have some instances where Turkish Cypriots were basically boarded on boats without knowing where they're being sent, and they wind up in Çanakkale as British soldiers to fight against the Ottomans at the Battle of Çanakkale. And in some instances, those Turkish Cypriots refused to fight against their fellow Turks. Many of them fled the battlefield, and many of them, as well as fleeing from the British Army, actually switched sides. They went to join the Ottoman forces against the British Army in the Battle of Çanakkale. And one of the reasons why we don't actually have much written about this is because many of those Turkish Cypriots were actually killed. They didn't return. There was no one to tell their story. So in terms of numbers, I really have no idea. But every Turkish Cypriot family somewhere down the line has some kind of story that they need to tell. And I hope that some of these stories can come out today. We have one name here called Mustafa Jorolik. He was a very popular Turkish Cypriot character in Lefkoşa during the 50s. He is recorded as being one of these Turkish Cypriots that were sent to Çanakkale as a British soldier and fled. And some of his work has been, some of his stories have been recorded by a writer called Ruby Keser. But we don't really have time to get into all of these stories now. Turkish Cypriots were also present on many other fronts for the Ottoman Empire against the invaders, against the British and the French. One I'd like to point out is a man called Dr. Esat. Him and his wife, Faika Hanum, were actually exiled by the British from Cyprus for sending supplies to the Ottoman forces. And they actually wind up in Mersin, participating in the War of Independence there. And also we have another character called Major Osman Necmi Bey. He fought on a number of fronts, and after 1919 he joined something called the Kureyşi Milliye, which is called the National Forces, and he participated in the 1924 War of Independence in Sakarya. We have another character called Mulazim Tahir Bey, who actually was very popular as a commander because he managed to guard the mountain from the invaders with just 15 soldiers and two machine guns for a total of 15 days until their reinforcements came. And there was another Turkish Cypriot known as Fatih Bey, who was awarded a medal for his efforts in Eskişehir in the War of Independence. And he was actually given the surname of Güvendiren by Atatürk himself. So Atatürk actually met many of these Turkish Cypriot fighters, soldiers, and gave them surnames and awarded them with medals. Again, we have many names there. I'm just going to skip those due to the lack of time. Also during these years, the Turkish Cypriots helped the Ottoman forces a lot through charity work. We need to keep in mind that during 1919, the Turkish Cypriots were mainly impoverished. There was a drought, there was a famine in Cyprus at the time. But despite this, Turkish Cypriots still managed to send a lot of financial support to the Ottoman troops. And we have some examples. We have the Briyeten Teraki Club, which was set up in 1920. And they sent £270 to Anatolia via the Hilali Ahmer, or Red Crescent in London. It was actually planned for Turkish Cypriots to send any kind of aid to the Ottoman forces. So a lot of this was done by ulterior means. And for example, they would send the money to the Red Crescent in London, which would then transfer it to the Ottoman forces because they couldn't donate directly. And I'd like to point out that £1 back then was equivalent to about £50 today. So £270 is equivalent to about £13,500 today. It's a lot of money for people who are impoverished. We have another organization called Muhacirin İslamiye Yardım Cemiyeti, which organized 22 different campaigns between 1920 and 1922 to help the national forces fight against Greeks in Western Anatolia. And they actually sent £600, which is equivalent to £30,000 today. There's another group called the Marif Geliştirme Cemiyeti, set up in Poli, Neşri Marif Cemiyeti, set up in Larnaca. A number of organizations were set up, and we don't have time to get into each and every one of them. On an individual basis, Turkish Cypriots also helped in many ways. Like notices were sent out, notices were sent out during Friday prayers to help, basically, to call on Turkish Cypriots to help the Ottoman forces. And like donations were made, appeals were made in newspapers, auctions were held to raise money. Many instances here. I mean, if we get into this in an answer session, I can give you more details. I could just give you more details on that when we have time, but I'd just like to move on because we have other speakers today. Regarding the struggle and the migration, when Britain annexed Cyprus in 1915, the Turkish Cypriots were overcome by something called the Crete trauma. Crete is an island, belongs to Greece today, just south of the mainland Greece. And there were actually Turks living in Crete at the time, Turkish Cretans. And Crete happened to suffer a similar fate to Cyprus, but a lot of those Cretans, actually all of them, were exiled from Crete. And many of them fled to Turkey, where they still live today. And there is even a community of Turkish Cretans in Syria, in Libya as well. Syria, there's one called Hamidiye. It's a place in Latakia, like a village along the coast that's purely Turkish Cretan. And so Turkish Cypriots had witnessed what happened to the Turks in Crete, and they were fearful of suffering the same fate. And they were especially scared when Britain offered Cyprus to Greece in 1915 in return for Greece's participation against Bulgaria in the Balkan region. But Greece actually rejected this offer. Greece was not prepared to fight Bulgaria on behalf of Britain. So Greece missed their opportunity to actually annex Cyprus at that time. And despite this, like, the activism against the British continued. Turkish Cypriots even organized their own militia with weapons that were sent by the Turkish secret services in Anatolia to rescue Ottoman prisoners of war who are being held in Famagusta. Mustafa will get into more details about that later. And Turkish Cypriots also started their own party called the Union with Turkey Party as well. Mustafa again will explain more about that. And what's really important is a date that I think everyone should keep in mind was on December 10th, 1918, Müftü Ziya Efendi and Efkafet İlfan Bey, Vatan newspaper owner Mehmet Şevket, and head teacher Mehmet Remzi Okan. I want you all to keep Mehmet Remzi Okan in mind. He is a very important character in the national struggle. They set up something called the Milli Meclis, the National Congress for Turkish Cypriots, where they basically made some demands for more rights for Turkish Cypriots from the British. They collected 200 delegates from all over Cyprus, Turkish Cypriot delegates, and they met for 3 days before coming to four conclusions. Again, we don't have time to get into that right now, but one of the main ones were the reinstatement of the position of the movement. Actually, in 1928, but basically the British had banned the position of the Müftü. Now, I mentioned before that the Müftü was the leader of the Turkish Cypriot community, and when the British got rid of that position, the Turkish Cypriots didn't have a leader to represent them in the way that they wanted to be represented. So they tried very hard to reinstate the Müftü, and they chose a man called Said Bey to take on this position, but the British continually rejected. So for a long time, the Turkish Cypriots didn't have any proper representation to the British government. And this Mehmet Remzi Okan, he was a very strong Turkish nationalist. He would teach children in schools how to sing a certain song called Yürüyelim İleriye, Atlayalım Tepeye. And when the British saw the influence that this song, which nationalistic song, was having on Turkish Cypriot youth, they banned it. They also banned a lot of Turkish books coming in from Anatolia, from schools as well. So what this man actually did was a very smart man. He taught the children how to whistle this song. So for a long time, Turkish Cypriot children were whistling this song instead of singing the words. In 1918, Russia got into an agreement with Germany, and Russia pulled out of World War I. They pulled out of Kars and places where they had annexed and taken from the Ottoman Empire. So the Ottoman Empire, realizing that the Russians were no longer a threat to British interests, had requested from the British to take Cyprus back, but the British still refused. Turkish Cypriots were also very eager to reunite with the Ottoman Empire, so they started demonstrating this in the media. Mehmet Remzi Okan again, he started a newspaper called Doğruyol with another lawyer called Ahmet Raşit, and this newspaper was censored, and then he started a new newspaper called Söz. He started many newspapers just to kind of promote Turkish nationalism, and he kept on getting shut down. And there were a number of newspapers and magazines that were coming out from this time. In 1925, the British officially annexed Cyprus as a crown colony, according to the Treaty of Lausanne, and Turkey actually recognized this. When this treaty was signed, we witnessed another wave of Turkish Cypriots leaving the island of Cyprus, because at this point, Turkey has accepted that Cyprus is British territory. Before, the Turkish Cypriots had hoped that Turkey would one day come back to Cyprus. When they lost that hope, they said, okay, we don't want to stay in Cyprus anymore, we want to go to Turkey. So there was another huge migration, and We have some numbers of these migrations actually. And the first people who left went to Konya. Around 3,000 settled in Konya, 3,000 in Kozan, 3,000 in Muğla, 3,000 in Adana, another 3,000 in Slivke, 3,000 in Antalya, 3,000 to Osmaniye, 2,000 to Mersin. And actually, near Antalya, there is a village called Yeniköy, which was set up in the 1930s, which is a Turkish Cypriot village. So we actually have Turkish Cypriot villages in southern Turkey, and they've been assimilated now into general Turkish culture. And in 1930, Turkey actually sent a consulate to Cyprus called Asaf Bey to help the Turks of Cyprus relocate to Anatolia. But the problem is that the rate of migration was so great that at that point, like, there were people who were commenting on the situation. They said that there was going to be no Turkish Cypriots left in Cyprus. They were all leaving for Turkey. And Atatürk actually realized the danger behind this. He wanted to leave some Turks behind in Turkey so that Turkey would still have some kind of right to Cyprus in the future. So at one point they were helping Turkish Cypriots migrate, but then after that point they decided that they needed to put a cap on it, and they started encouraging Turkish Cypriots to stay. And that's why we probably didn't leave, why our families probably didn't leave. And in 1930, the Halkçılar, the people who vote for their candidates, the real candidates that represent the people, managed to get into the Legislative Council through democratic elections. Mehmet Necati Özkan was the main leader of the Turkish nationalistic camp. He managed to get into the parliament, and in 1931 he unfurled the Turkish flag in a national congress which was formed by himself. And this was very symbolic because the British had actually banned the Turkish flag from being seen anywhere in Cyprus. Children were banned from drawing it in classrooms, and whenever films were coming from Turkey and were shown in the cinema, the British would actually literally cut out the scenes where there was a Turkish flag in order to avoid Turkish nationalism. So the act of unfurling that Turkish flag was a very symbolic act. And this was just when the Turkish Cypriots were getting what they wanted. They were getting their, they were starting to get their rights from the British authorities. Just when this happened, a rebellion started in Cyprus, mainly by the Greek Cypriots, who were wanting to have the island with Greece. And all democratic, the entire democratic process in Cyprus was banned. It was lifted, and the British became authoritarian in the region, and this continued like this until the end of World War II, when a lot of the people who were exiled, both Turkish Cypriot and Greek Cypriots, were allowed to come back. And however, when they came back to Cyprus after the end of World War II, it was a different Cyprus to the one that they had left. When they left Cyprus, it was about Cypriots in general, Turkish Cypriots and Greek Cypriots having their own parallel agendas against a British authority. But by the end of the World War II, the British were beginning to consider pulling out of Cyprus, and it became a struggle actually between Turkish Cypriots and Greek Cypriots to see who can get more rights over the other in a future state, which was later to be declared as the Republic of Cyprus in 1960. And from there we all know what happened. That part of history is something that's spoken about often, spoken about a lot, but unfortunately much of our history before 1960 is ignored. So that's what I've tried to kind of bring out in my talk today. I apologize if I went on a bit too long. Sorry for my voice failing me as well. But I hope you were enlightened by this brief talk. I wish I could speak more. But out of respect for the other speakers, I think I will call it bring it to an end there. Thank you very much.